morning, everyone. I'm Charlotte, and I welcome you to Mount Adam Pilgrim's Chapel. In my best Jim Whitworth impression, I'm going to tell you a little story about a boy who learned in Sunday school that God created Eve from Adam's rib. Later that day, his mother found him laying on the floor with his shirt pulled up, poking around on his rib cage. When she asked him what he was doing, he said, "I've got a pain here. I think I'm having a wife." We come to worship and praise our God and to learn more about the wonders of our God. How great and wonderful is our compassionate God. We come with ears and hearts open to God, ready to discover more of God's mysteries and miracles. How generous and caring is our unchanging God. We gather to share together in our common history and to experience the enrichment which that brings us. All praise and honor to God for past and present blessings and for God's merciful love and grace. Amen. Join me in the opening prayer. God, you split rocks in the wilderness and gave your people abundant drink as from the deep. Come to us, Lord. Give us that abundant water. You made streams come out of the rock and caused waters to flow down like rivers. Come to us, Lord. Send the waters down upon us. You turned the desert into pools of water, the parched land into springs of water. Come to us, Lord. Create springs in the parched deserts of our hearts. As a deer longs for flowing stream, so my soul longs for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Come to us, Lord, and fill our longing. Amen. Thank you. now please join me in a responsive reading of the Canticle of Christ's Obedience. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in our likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Amen. The scripture today comes from the New Testament, Matthew 21, verses 23 through 32. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while he was teaching, the chief priests and elders of the people came to him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked, "and who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, "I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from men?" They discussed it among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say from men, we are afraid of the people, for they all hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then he said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work today in the vineyard.' 'I will not,' he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, 'I will, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted?" "The first," they answered. Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you had not repented and believed him." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
earliest verses of the 21st chapter of Matthew, tells of Jesus' triumphal march into Jerusalem, followed by his cleansing of the temple. The cleansing of the temple precipitates the confrontation between Jesus and the chief priests, most of whom were probably Sadducees, but that's a discussion for another day, and elders that were mentioned in our gospel lesson. Presumably, these include members of the Sanhedrin, including Caiaphas, whom this gospel identifies as high priest. It is their authority that Jesus defied when he expelled the sellers of the animals and overturned the tables of the money changers, because their presence in the temple would be required the approval of religious authorities to conduct their business. Of Herod's building projects, none were greater than the Jerusalem temple. That took 1,000 priests and 10,000 laborers 9 years to complete and is referred to as Herod's temple. It sat on what we now call the Temple Mount, an area of some 35 acres. Only priests could enter the area immediately adjacent to the temple itself, which took up a small part of the mount and was surrounded by three courts. Israelite men could enter the court closest to the temple. Israelite women and men, with their men, could occupy the next court, but the court of the Gentiles, which the court was the court farthest from the temple, was the closest any non-Jew could get to the sanctuary. In fact, there were warning signs posted around the limits where the Gentiles were permitted to go. These signs were written in Greek and read as follows. No outsider shall enter the protective enclosure around the sanctuary, and whoever is caught will only have himself to blame for the ensuing death. I think they were serious. The idea of money changers and sellers of animals probably started innocently enough. Torah law prescribes that temple offerings be free of blemish. Bringing an animal a long distance would be impractical because the animal might be injured along the road and then rendered unsuitable for sacrifice. Therefore, people coming from afar needed a place to exchange money and to purchase a suitable offering. Most Jews also paid the temple tax at Passover, typically a half shekel. The money changers were there to convert Roman and foreign currency, usually containing pagan mottos and images, making it unacceptable for Yahweh's house, into acceptable currency. Having those services available at the temple met a genuine human need. But those services evolved into profitable concessions and then into substantial businesses. The temple became less a place for God's prophets and more a place for personal profits. Some sellers actually were overcharging for the currency exchange and also exploiting those in poverty, the poor man's offering of pigeons and doves. In addition, many of the unscrupulous priests who were responsible for inspecting the offering to make sure it met the standards for a sacrifice would declare a perfectly good animal as unfit in order to sell the pilgrim another animal. He would then turn around and sell the animal he had confiscated to another pilgrim whose sacrifice did not meet the standard. And to make things worse, these merchants set up shop in the court of the Gentiles, making it useless as a place of prayer due to the hustle and bustle and the buying and selling that were created. These activities, having started innocently enough, seem to have evolved into an organized crime-like enterprise. Jesus didn't try to engage the money changers in debate, nor did he ask approval before he just authoritatively walked into the temple and began spilling money on the floor, saying, "It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers." This was very Messiah-like, an action that was noticed by the priests and elders who were present at the time. After clearing the temple, Jesus spent time healing several sick and lame people, for which the children present in the temple were praising him. But the priests and elders who witnessed the removal of the concessions and the healing acts and heard the praises of the children became indignant. When they asked Jesus, "Do you hear what they are saying?" He replied, "Yes. Have you never read, 'From the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise?'" A short time later, Jesus left Jerusalem to spend the night in Bethany. He returned in the morning to the temple the next day and teaching when he was appropriately and was teaching when he was approached by the chief priests and the elders. They challenged Jesus by asking him, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" In that day, the chief priests and elders were responsible for the religious life of Israel and the operation of the temple. Their authority came from God, so it was entirely appropriate for them to question Jesus' authority to disrupt the temple routine. There were established procedures for transmitting that authority from one generation to the next. In most cases, a candidate would be examined for worthiness. A priest or rabbi would lay hands on the candidate, preferably in a public ceremony. This not only served to transmit God's authority, but also protected people from interlopers and false prophets. The church still recognizes the validity of these procedures today and practices the laying on of hands. Who gave this authority to Jesus? To whom is he accountable? By asking Jesus the source of his authority, the chief priests and scribes believe they are giving Jesus enough rope to hang himself. If he claims that his authority comes from God, they can drill down to expose the weak foundation of such a claim. If he says that he is the Messiah, they can then cite him for blasphemy. We can be sure that they feel certain of the ground on which they stand and the weakness of any case that Jesus might present. But Jesus responds to the question with a question, which is a standard rabbinical technique of argument. Responding with a question might seem evasive, but Jesus makes a daring promise that if they answer his question, he will tell them by what authority he does these things. Instead of ducking their question, he steps out onto the high wire, daring them to follow. He asks, "The baptism of John, where was it from? From heaven or from men?" By asking those questions, Jesus is implying that his authority is from the same source as John's. Jesus' question places the chief priests and elders in a dilemma. If they say that John's baptism was from heaven, they are faced with John's witness to Jesus and their own failure to respond to John's preaching. If, on the other hand, they say that John's baptism was not from heaven, they fear that the crowd who believes in John will turn on them. They knew they were about to step out under that high wire where Jesus was standing. So they answered, "I don't know." It is a weak answer from those who are responsible for the nation's religious life, a response that was obviously prompted by politically sensitive poll-taking necessity. Does that have a familiar contemporary ring to it? It is their responsibility to know who is and who is not a false prophet. It is their responsibility to protect the people from false prophets. By refusing to answer, they abdicate their responsibility and compromise their authority. When the chief priests and elders refuse to answer Jesus' question, he refuses to answer theirs, thereby rejecting their authority to examine him. Jesus follows his refusal with three parables, the first of which found only in Matthew, we will discuss now, the parable of the two sons. The religious leaders had dodged the question about John's authority, but they cannot dodge this story, the point of which is more obvious. The religious leaders had dodged the question about John's authority, but they cannot dodge a story, the point of which is more obvious. Jesus asked them, "What do you think of this?" Jesus then relates the story of a man who had two sons. He went to the first and told him to go to work today in his vineyard. The son refused, but then thought better of it later on and went to work in the vineyard. The man then went to his second son and told him the same thing. The second son replied that he would, but never went to the vineyard. Jesus then asked the priests and elders, "Which one obeyed the father?" They replied, "The first one." The first son says, "I will not," but later changes his mind and does what is needed. The second son says he will go, but does not. Both sons are guilty of violating the commandment, "Honor your father and your mother." Which son sinned most grievously? This parable makes it pretty clear that the tax collectors and prostitutes, also known as sinners, are the first son, ultimately obedient. And the chief priests and elders are the second son, ultimately disobedient. Jesus then tells the priests and elders that the sinners will get into heaven before they do. When John the Baptist called people to repent, tax collectors and prostitutes repented and were baptized. It was easy for them to repent because their sins were obvious even to them. The religious leaders, however, really did not want to admit their need for repentance and rejected John's call. Their disobedience was rooted in part on good intentions. They had become so intent on analyzing God's law that they had made a snarl of it. But their disobedience was rooted in larger measure in the spiritual pride that made it impossible for them to recognize that they were sinners, that they too needed to repent, that they had much in common with the sinners whom they despised. The question then is, what does this have to do with us? We are living in the same dialogue. We are in a time within our churches and across much of the Christian world, we are being challenged with the question of authority. This is not a question of denominational structure or local church structures, but rather a question of where can we best hear of and be embraced by, be liberated with, and be responsible to the God who created, redeemed, and sanctified us. We may miss the challenge of this passage if we simply interpret it as a call to go to our highways and byways and find outsiders, the outsiders of our day, as right as that might be, but then to fail to see the challenge to us as individuals and communities of faith. Shane Hipps, in his book, Selling Water by the River, has a wonderful quote that captures some of what is going on in this passage. Some, in an effort to protect and preserve the gospel message, have become like guards in the museum, the priests and elders, fueled by fear that its treasures could be damaged or stolen if they are not vigilant in their watch. They have mistaken the good news for an ancient artifact that needs to be protected. But that is not its nature. This kingdom is a lot more like a tree. God is looking for gardeners, not guards. A guard is trained in a defensive stance of fear and suspicion. A gardener is motivated by love and creativity. Just maybe this passage about the two sons is challenging us to consider the ways we act as the second son. After all these years, we may be the ones who are confronted daily by fresh and sometimes strange voices who are calling for a kind of faithfulness that seems foreign to us. All around us, we, the inheritors of a rich history, can hear the voice of Jesus speaking to us in a strange tempo that perks up our ears, while at the same time causing a feeling of discomfort. We desire a faithful response to God's call, but many times wind up as guards in a museum protecting a treasure. There is also the possibility that we, as followers of the way of Jesus and as members of the church, may wind up like the first son, resisting the voice of God and refusing to follow in the way he tells us to, but eventually working as master gardeners in an ever-growing garden. Are we in need of fresh eyes and changed hearts in order to be faithful to God that was revealed to us in Jesus? Should it be a constant challenge for us to follow Jesus, a person who regularly confronted the priests and elders, who's entrenched in calcified authorities, in order to bring about new birth? Given the age of Christianity and its identification with so much of society in Western world today, are we now in the position of the chief priests and the elders? Have we become guards of an ancient treasure, or are we gardeners growing both heirloom plants and sturdy hybrids and adapting as the garden grows?
Thank you.
It's now time for the pastoral prayer. But before we get started, I've been greatly affected by what I see in the news of senseless killings, rioting, political upheaval, the pandemic, raging wildfires, and multiple hurricanes. I feel nausea, frustration, anger, and numbness. How about you? I find myself saying things like, I just can't, or when will it ever change, or what can I do? So today in prayer, let us embody the horror we feel. Let us guard against becoming numb. For through that embodiment will come empowerment. Let us pray. God, do not spare us. Do not spare us the feelings of rage that come to the surface as we read headlines, see graphic, obscene videos, view pictures, and hear the same narrative unfold time and time again. Do not spare us, for we may grow complacent, complicit, or apathetic. Why, O God, must this kind of division, hatred, and violence continue? How long until this changes? How, O Lord, can you use us as instruments of change? These are our prayers that leave our lips and hearts as we sit in a sense of bewilderment. Hear our prayers. Help us embody all that we feel. Meet us in our complaint and in our pleas. For when we cry out to you, how long, O Lord? We are not looking for a timeline. We are needing to lament. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our cry. God, we pray today for those whose lives have been lost or destroyed in the senseless violence across our nation, the hurricanes that have ripped through our southern states, the wildfires out west, and the pandemic that seems to have no end. We see you work and move through these disasters, providing guidance, comfort, relief, shelter, and funding to help those who are now homeless. We thank you for those on the front lines of these events. We ask that you work and move through us as well. In the wake of these disasters are a collection of broken dreams. You have been rebuilding and imagining our dreams for centuries. Do so once again. We pause now to think about those in our small community who are unable to be in this meeting house with us today. Some of those names have been spoken here while others are in our hearts. Hear our silent prayers. We pray that you grant them comfort, hope, and healing. God, in the midst of all this heavy stuff, we are also heavy with gratitude. You have blessed our lives in unimaginable ways. You have helped us dream new dreams for ourselves and for our world. Grant us courage and surround us by faithful community so that we may actualize our dreams together. In Jesus' name, amen. And now let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you.
Friends in Christ, our God is patient, steadfast, and understanding. Christ hears us and knows our hearts inside and out. The one who created us promises to care for us. So as we go forth, let us do so feeling affirmed and loved. May we show others the love, light, and hope we have shared here today. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Amen.